Bam. Made it. Oh, I can't believe it. The orchard picked up the computer. My baby 2015 MacBook. That's what we're gonna have to be using to do this, to start. But it's just a start. And now we're going for it. Back onto the bus. And we're gonna head over to the mall to try to pick up some shoes. Wow. Haven't even edited anything yet. Very tough. Making those packing decisions. Ooh, it's a disaster in here. But we're well on our way. Here's the hard part. Last time I took a whole suitcase full of books. All my whole Burmese collection, which I can't remember the name now, but yeah, a whole series of books, probably the best language books for Burmese you could find. I can't remember the guy's name. There's only really that one series. Oh, just so many books that I eventually just had to leave. I had to leave because I was paying so much every time I'd move. In baggage fees that I was like, I can't. And now I wish I would have just had a home base and kept those books there. That's what we're gonna do. So now you see in here, this bin, all my old stuff my folks brought me. Well, at least what's left of it anyway. And two things that I took pictures of because I want to keep a record of are these two old journals from when I was a kid that even talk about traveling and figuring out why people are happy, what makes them happy. But these two books, I think I need to take with me, at least these two. I mean, this one just because, how can you not? It's been probably the most valuable Thai book that I've had. And as you can see, it's well worn. Man, I used the hell out of this book. It is excellent. I haven't used it in a long time. But anytime I need to reference some grammar or like clarify something, you can see it's bootleg. When I first got it, all of us language learners at the time, this bootleg. people had copies, and we're in Thailand, you just made a copy. This one, I have no idea how it came about, you know what I mean? Both of these, Orchid and White Lotus, are just local Southeast Asian publishers, as far as I remember. And yeah, that's how you're gonna get published if you're doing like a very unique, very specific language back then. Even Thai still has, I mean, by far the most resources, but still wasn't a lot. And now it's tons. I mean, you go to the bookstore and absolutely jam-packed full of language learning books. But however, over the years, you realize there are only a few that are actually decent. Most of them are just junk. And yeah, these ones stayed with me. This one is really good, but you gotta be in the mood, man. You can see it's pretty technical. What else can you say? Hey, there's an old bookmark. Yeah, this one's a little bit, I don't know. If I remember it, it's a little tougher than this one, being like very simple, easier to understand, at least from what I remember. I haven't dove into these in so long that I can't tell you for sure, but I wanted to take a video because I can't take all of these books with me one day. Once I just am afraid to take them. I don't want to lose them. They're so good. Look at that. Old Cambodian, beginner Cambodian, Burmese. That's the other books I lost. All my freaking awesome Cambodian books. I was such a nerd in college. Didn't even get a chance to use them like I wanted to. But we're going to now, because we're going back to Well, we're not going back, but we're going to Laos. The other thing I wanted to film was the amount of journals that are in here. But that, you can't really see them, can you? But underneath all of these language books, the whole bottom basically is just journals from my first experience in Thailand. I kept a journal for every single day that I was there. So yeah, that was something that another person said the only thing that they regretted about their experience, not regretted, but the only thing they wish they would have done was document it, was to write a journal, because those memories fade. So here we are again with the need to document, but we're going to do it on film this time. Then maybe I'll actually watch it, or, you know, people might watch it, but I would love to take those with me, because there's stories, you know, and experiences, like all those times, those first times I ate food, like Khai Mot Daeng. I like all out there. Whenever I ate something new, I met somebody, learned something, there's so much in there. Now it's just 100% focus on making this into a viable source of income. Because if I can make enough money doing this, that's all I'm gonna do. All I need is enough to live on, you know? I'm not a greedy sucker. I don't live on much, to be honest. You'll see. People will see, I guess, if I don't edit that shite out. But yeah, I don't live on much. So as long as I can, even like $1,000, obviously like 2,000, the more you make, the more interesting videos I can make. But from the beginning, it's all gonna be pay rent, food costs, and just make this happen. Damn, I'm excited. Let's go. Quick, because it's weird to film in the bathroom, but you know you're in Asia. And the bathrooms are pristine. Check it out. Now he's even got a seat for your kid. Bam. Doesn't look that nice. But yeah. Got the bidet and everything. And it's not working. Here in Seoul. Wow. We made it. I did not film on the way to the airport this morning in Phoenix, nor in LA. Nothing up until this point. I was too nervous. It is stressful traveling. You forget how stressful it is. And all I wanted to do is make sure that I took care of everything. I had the energy and the patience to take care of everything you need to take care of, because you never know. And sure enough, right when I got there, they tried to pull the whole, oh, you gotta pay $100 extra for your baggage. And anybody that's traveled, especially internationally or moved internationally, you know that check your flights for a 2-baggage allowance. I made sure that I had 2-baggage allowance, of course, and I was not going to give in when I clearly wasn't trying to cheat the system. My second bag was just a duffel bag with maybe 10, 15 kilos in it, not even near the 42 kilo limit or whatever it is. So yeah, it's like, no, look, had to show them my thing. And they still kept telling me, supervisor kept telling me that I was gonna have to pay the $100 for a checked bag. Nah, we'll get on the phone if we have to. We'll be here for a minute if we have to, cause it's $100 and I could just pay it, but I already paid over $1,000 for the ticket and 2 checked bags. And it wasn't much of a bag anyways, like, so yeah. But I hear that happen a lot, so just be careful if you are traveling, especially a 2-bag limit. Make sure you find the one with a 2-bag limit, because they're ripping you off if you don't, if you need to anyway. And don't let them try to tell you that you gotta pay extra if you already paid. Push, you gotta, because I think they're doing that trick, you know, sell the ticket and be like, oh, we're not associated with that airline. I'm like, it says right here that I'm using this airline and operated by you guys, United Airlines. So you can't tell me I'm gonna have to pay another $100. Anyways, that's boring stuff. That's a boring, frustrating part of travel. The cool part of travel is being in a different country, in Korea, and you see a Dunkin' Donuts. Not that I'd ever eat that, but it does exist around the world. Yeah, I want to see some of this airport because it's pretty cool. As with all airports, a bunch of the luxury brands that, you know, silly people buy, but they're here. I've been to some cool airports. Taipei is one off the top of my head that I'm like, I wish I would have been filming at that time, because that's a cool airport. Same with Bangkok. Seoul is no different. Amazing airport. Really well put together. Charging station, charging places everywhere, free Wi-Fi. I freaking love you, Korea. I really do. I have zero things to say about Korea other than good things. Their airlines are legit. The food is unbelievable. So soon I'm gonna come back to Korea. I gotta come to Korea. I absolutely love the food. Me and my ex used to eat it all the time. That was our go-to, you know? She was also Asian. She was Thai at the time. She's always been Thai, will always be Thai. But in the States, you know, we'd always go. That was our choice for eating out. Because burgers suck, yo. Now, everybody likes a decent burger, but I'm not going out to eat to get a freaking burger. It takes no effort or talent to make a burger. I love to cook, come on, y'all. Let's stop pretending like burgers and Tex-Mex is actually a cuisine, actually it takes effort or any kind of talent to make. But I'm being a downer, so we'll edit that out. This doesn't even feel real. I think part of me was just psyched out. That's why I didn't film. It's like, this is even real? Are you crazy? You know that feeling every time you're taking on something so big? You're like, I'm probably crazy. People are probably right. You know, the voices start creeping into your head. And you have to remind yourself of your why you're doing it. And this is for me. So I want to document this. But obviously there's some much, much deeper meaning to it. Things that everybody will know eventually, you know, as we get to know each other. But I mean, this is me, and yeah, this means a lot to me. So I'm pretty nervous, pretty determined. And every time I think about filming, I second guess myself and wonder if I'm just absolutely out of my mind. But then again, I've seen how many people do this, make a living off of doing this, and that's nothing to do with why I want to do it. I've wanted to do it since I was in college. I've mentioned this a million times. I can remember being in college, sitting at a baseball field, thinking, oh, this would be cool to share with my friends overseas, internationally, all the people that don't get to see. You know, everything's happiness, everything needs to, doesn't exist without sharing. So I don't know if you're looking at my neck or what. Just getting used to filming with this thing. Yeah, take a little gander at some of these shops. Don't even know, this is duty free. I haven't had anybody tell me to not film in here, so we'll film. Yeah. I was saying I've always wanted to be a content creator, and that's the truth. I know it's been harder to even convince myself to do it lately because it's become the mainstream, you know, doing your own thing, following your passion. It used to be just like you had to vlog and that, and then hope that you could figure out a way to monetize it in some way. But now we live in a time that you can literally follow any passion you like if you're really passionate about it and share it, and you can make a living off of it and create businesses through it. And so here we are, you know. From the time I was a kid, I wanted to be a sports broadcaster. Got home from my first experience overseas and wanted to do international business, but I knew I wanted to do something internationally. And yeah, I was diving into all that stuff when I was in college, trying to figure out what the 4-hour work week, Tim Ferriss, vlogging, like how to escape the 9-to-5 and create your own reality, create your own life that you want to be living and not within the system of just go to your 9-to-5, get no vacation, and you're trapped in the system where you're not ever really spending your time what you really want to be doing. So to me, that's most important. You know, I don't want to be asking anybody else, hey, do you think I could get off this day to spend time with my kids or my family or do anything that's important to me? I don't want to go asking anybody. So, after years of trying to figure out how to make money on my own and feeling like I'm pretty successful with whatever I try, but then over the years is, you just get beaten down, I guess, and I started to feel like I was just failing at everything I tried. And really tired of working for people asking me to do things that I don't agree with morally. Most of the time, yeah. I mean, it all makes sense when it comes together, you know what I mean? You don't want to ask people to go spend time doing things that you really should be doing. You don't want to have to do things that you know aren't right when an employer says, hey, just this little white lie to customers, or just do this, that, and the other, and you're like, what? And talking to people like, yeah, I sold this person, made all this money. But and then little do they know that I charged them way more than they could have got it for. And I'm just thinking to myself, like, all these things over the years of like just not being able to stand working for other people because of, like, no, it's not okay. Well, I want to believe in what I'm doing. Like, first of all, it needs to be a product or something that actually can help people in some way or another. And secondly, I'm not going to lie to sell your product. I'm not going to lie to, or white lies or whatever it is, like, just constantly, you know? Every employer is asking you to do things that, you know, isn't kind to other people. That's not kind. And that's this whole, like, system we live within. It's, well, it's okay. Everybody has to make a buck. Why do you think so many of us, why are so many people struggling then? You know, maybe I'm going to switch that mindset a bit. Like, maybe it's worth not making a buck to be kind to people. Huh? There's a thought. Anyways, I'm taking away from this moment, being in here ranting about God knows what. But yeah, always wanted to do this. I think I found the spot. Food Empire, Multicultural Gourmet Kitchen. Let's check this out. Right next to the Paris Baguette. Had it before, pretty common chain around Asia. I'm not a huge fan. I'm a little bit picky with pastry places because it's very different. If you ever try a pastry in Thailand or in Asia, they'll tend to be real airy and very sugary. So, if you grew up in the West, where you remember smelling mom's homemade cookies cooking in the morning, then you're not gonna get that unless you find a specific place that does Western style. Holy smokes, this place is small quarters to work with. Yes, good food. I bought food and oh my god, they got Taco Bell over there. Get shit on it. Enjoy a couple of bean burritos when I'm desperate. But yeah, I just bought some cheap KFC when I was in LA because I wasn't looking to spend $20-$30 on the shit food there. Sorry guys, I'm very opinionated when it comes to food. I wanted to spend money if I was going to spend it here in Korea. Or first I thought I was going to Japan. The whole time I thought I was leaving in the morning and flying to Japan. And I ended up getting there in the morning. And they're like, your flight's tonight. And you're going to Seoul, so. Hey. Tempting with the beer here, isn't it? It's very tempting. I just wish I was more hungry. I'm like struggling. Because I know once I get to Laos, I gotta get the visa, and it's just not gonna be a quick process. It never is when you're doing all that stuff. Get my luggage. By the time I get food, it could be another 8 hours, so I'm gonna have to pour something down. It's tragic when you have all this good food here and you're spending that much money at the airport. Oh, yeah, I think I want a pork cutlet. That is fire. Olive green, of course. I don't remember, but I remember the system being pretty easy. The writing system, that is. Yes, I did look at it a bit. What else do you expect from a language note? Any language like this that's interesting, I've definitely had a little dabble in to see how it works. And their systems. It's pretty phenomenal, to be honest. What drinks do we got in here? So I was about to order some food, but they said like 10-15 minutes for the person in front of me. That would make it 30 minutes before my flight leaves when I get my food. I'm gonna go check and see if I can get my boarding pass. And most of all, I just can't stomach it, you know? I'm hungry enough, like I want a snack, but I just want some fruit. I'm not hungry enough to sit down and really enjoy the money I'd be spending on a pork cutlet, which is freaking delicious. I love a Korean or a Japanese pork cutlet with the gravy and everything. Mmm, yum. But also not trying to spend $15 just to inhale something and jump on the plane. So let's go see if we can get our boarding pass. It's kind of dark on my eyes all the time with this hat on, ain't it? Hi. Good call on the boarding pass, because I just came and got it and they start boarding in 10 minutes. I would have literally had to rush and eat that, so might be a little hangry when we get there, but who cares? I'm about to buy the best food in the world for pennies on the dollar. But check out Korea first. I've been wanting to explore this country for so long, but Korea and Japan just have not been in the budget for a teacher. They have not been in the teacher's budget. So, just been traveling locally wherever I live. But eventually, sooner than later, we're gonna do Korea. Am I filming too much? We're getting on the plane! Dude. We're getting on the plane. We're on the plane, Lao Airlines.
How many
advertisements we got here.
Got some insurance for sale up here.
Sorry, y'all. I know this isn't that interesting for some, but for language learners, every sign is an opportunity to learn. About to get some food. To come to Laos one time. I'm pretty sure that was for the new year. Lao New Year, Thai New Year. We made it, guys. Flipping, thought I was gonna die on the way down. Never had motion sickness before. Hey, there's my luggage, that red suitcase down there. Thank goodness. Now let's pray that my OGO bag made it, because that was one that was concerning me. Just that little OGO duffel bag. And I had to fight for, oh, I see it down there. Yes! Dude, that's concerning. When they were like, oh, you gotta pay for luggage at the very beginning of the trip and this down there. I think that's what actually finally got them to make me, to give me the right deal on it, you know, that I already paid for and not charge me extra, because I said, no, I want to talk to somebody. I'm really concerned that my luggage isn't gonna make it there. Like, not only are you trying to charge me, and you're saying I gotta pick it up in Seoul and recheck in, and they're gonna try to charge me again. This is not what I paid for. I need to talk to somebody, because I can't lose my bag. This is a big move, and I can't be losing my bags. Finally, they just let me go for free. Hell yes, guys.
Hell yes!
Now, where do we go get a photo? And contact Nawali that we have arrived and need somebody to come pick us up. I'm loving this, guys. This is literally a dream come true. I just went to Luang Prabang the one time I've been, just for the week or so of Be My Lao, or Songkran, as some of you would know, over around the rest of Southeast Asia, Thailand and whatnot. I don't know if it's just changed a lot in the last few years, but it was, and there wasn't much when I came to Luang Prabang. It was pretty bare. Oh, this is not fun, so let's just turn.
I got lucky, guys. Do not show up here without pictures for your visa. You're gonna be screwed, so don't do what I did. I got lucky that I speak the language and they took care of me. I didn't know the address of my place, I didn't have my picture, and they took care of me. But don't do that to them. I feel really bad. They're really kind to me, as always, and what was I gonna say? Oh yeah, they do have change for your visa fees. They didn't do that in the past. You'd have exact $40 in cash, but not this time. Here, but I'm coming out. This is amazing. I'm freaking here, guys. Hey! Nawali! I can't believe I'm here!
Oh my god.
Đến đây, đồn
po. Đồn po. Sabai đi.